into the later part of the 1970s. So you've seen quite a bit happening, because we started with the Schmidt brothers. Fair to say that the sounds of quartets, the style of singing, the types of arrangements have gone through several changes. And this, of course, is the age of the great coach. Lyle Pilcher, Don Claus were the prime ones. And really, this is an entry into, you know, the modern barbershop world. I think you could say that the Bluegrass Student Union that we're about to listen to sound like a quartet that could be popular today. They stood up on stage and did what they did. They'd be a contender to win international now, right? The music's not that much different now than then. So, the Bluegrass Student Union. This is a Hall of Fame quartet. The Bluegrass Student Union certainly are a deserving quartet to be in the Hall of Fame. When they won in 1978, it had been a while. They were very young. And it had been a while since a youth quartet had won. In fact, going back and thinking about it, it might have been the last youth, you know, what you might call youth quartet, been in their early 20s, might have been the 14s. And all those quartets through the 50s and 60s were, I mean, they weren't old men, but they were probably men in their 30s, some in their 40s. So there you had it. It was just an injection of youth into barbershop, and they had an incredible ring. This was kind of like the experience I'm sure that people had in 1952 with the 14s, where they just had never heard chords ring like that before. And I mean, these guys just rang chords like you wouldn't believe. So let's listen to them.
There will be no more sorrow. That are endless days long as years. There will be laughter and song everywhere for someone. Sweetheart Sally, I found my long lost pal. My pal. Now this Sally is back in our alley.
Now I remember when they sang that song. This was in Cincinnati, and this was a year that I almost didn't go to international. I'm glad I did, because now I've got a steady, you know, since the first time I went, which was 1976, I've been to international every year. This year I wasn't going to go. I wasn't going to go, but there was a guy in the chorus I was directing, the old St. Louis number one chorus, that said he was going to go, and if I could go, if I wanted to go. He didn't have anybody to ride with him and didn't have anybody to room with, and so, okay, I went along with him. So fortunately I made it there. And I will never forget these guys walking out on stage. When they walked out on stage and sang that song with that big tag that it's got, it just, phew, it beat anything I'd ever heard. Of course, I hadn't been around barbershop that long. That was only my third international, but I can tell you that I had never heard anything like that in my short span of barbershop. And I thought, okay, now here's somebody that can ring chords like the Suntones can ring chords. That's what I thought. And finally, I found somebody who can do it like the Suntones. And they went on to be a great quartet in so many ways. You know, for the great quartets, winning the gold medal is a beginning. It's a beginning. If that's the end all, that's not a great quartet. It's a championship quartet. They had to be pretty good or they wouldn't have won. But the ones that make a mark on the culture are the ones that do something thereafter. This quartet has a great legacy, and it's captured in the CD package called Legacy, which I recommend. It's their complete works of all the recordings. And their recordings were just, oh, masterful. They were so masterful. And they had Walter Latsko commissioned to write arrangements for them. They had Ed Wasey. Those two arrangers were doing just about all of their stuff. And it was just new stuff. It was creative, innovative. They inspired a whole generation. Here's another one of their songs that everybody remembers. This, their Jukebox Saturday Night recording. Well, Barbershop hadn't gotten so excited since the Suntones recorded.
Help to make things bright. Mixing hot licks with vanilla. Jukebox Saturday Night. They put nothing past us, me and Honey Lamb. Making one coke last us till it's time to scram. Take it on the lamb, money, we really don't need that. We make out all right. Let the other guy feed that jukebox Saturday.
That was just great stuff, and it really, really, really made a mark. Now, I mentioned Ed Wasey. I could have slid him in earlier, but because the arrangement that was done by the Regents that I played, he also did that one. Something about every light on Broadway. I can't remember the name of that song, but that was Ed's arrangement. Not You Can Have Every Light on Broadway, but There's a Broken Heart for Every... Yeah, every light on Broadway. But Ed, arguably the most prolific creative arranger in the history of barbershop harmony. His many landmark arrangements include Midnight Rose, that he did for the Bluegrass Student Union. I Found My Sweetheart Sally's not even listed there, but certainly that one. The Three Girls Medley was viewed as an epic, iconic arrangement back when it appears back in the 1980s. The construction of three songs about girls, and then the book ending added material that he created for that. The famous Mardi Gras medley that the Louisville Thoroughbreds sang in the early 80s and astounded the world with. We'll see a video of that. Keep Your Sunny Side Up was sung over and over and over again. That might have been premiered by the Dukes of Harmony, okay, in 77 with Ray Danley directing, yeah. Jeannie with the Light Brown Hair, that second edition sang for us. Somewhere Over the Rainbow from second edition. Tour and Lure Lure, the acoustics sang that one. I'm Afraid the Masquerade is Over, I guess that was acoustics too. Swanee, Bluegrass, yeah. And then the Thoroughbreds, yeah. When Day Is Done, let's see, I guess Masters of Harmony sang that. Were they the first ones to do it,
yes,
to make it popular? And, you know, How Deep Is the Ocean, that's been done by many groups. So, and I should say Ed is also a Hall of Famer, rightfully so. Ed passed away 5-6 years ago. Great barbershopper. One of the most... enigmatic people, I think is the right adjective I could describe. I mean, there are so many Ed Wasey stories, and I remember when we roasted him at Harmony College, it was one of the best roasts ever. Were you there?
No.
I mean, he was a target as broad as a barn. I mean, Ed was just, he had so many quirks, but he was sort of lovable. I mean, just to tell one Ed Wasey story that Steve's heard me tell, you know, he could be very inconsistent with himself. And as a judge, you know, he was a little inconsistent, but some quartet went, asked him if they could sing, what's the song they asked him about?
This was in Ontario.
This was Ontario.
Don't Blame Me.
They asked him to sing Don't Blame Me, because back under the, you know, arrangement category, that was would have been frowned on. And even when our music category started up, it was a little bit on the edge. So somebody asked him if they could sing Don't Blame Me, and they said, yeah, it's a little bit, it's okay. And then they sang it, and he was on the judging panel, and he gave them a zero. So that's our friend Ed Wasey. But he was very creative, very intelligent, and was president of our society for a term. Now, this is another Ed Wayshe thing, and I'm going to play the bluegrass singing this while we look at the music, because the point of this is to realize by this, so now we're in the late 70s, how good our barbershop arrangers were getting at accommodating melody lines. This is Paper Doll. And you can see that this is a melody that kind of jumps all over the place, has a few accidentals in it, not too many, but just, you know, has to take a lot of tricks to harmonize. And notice the number of what the old barbershoppers would call minors. A minor is any chord with an altered scale tone. And just look what has to happen there. So, I mean, we take this for granted now, but you know, a song like this would have stymied somebody in the 1940s, Molly Regan or Phil Embry. They would have said, you can't harmonize that. There's just too much. We don't have that many neighboring chords.
Where I can buy a paper doll that I can call my own, a doll that other fellows cannot steal. And then the flirty, flirty guys with their flirty, flirty eyes will have to flirt with dollies that are real. When I come home at night...
I mean, that's not... I wouldn't say... I don't offer that because it's brilliant arranging. It's what any of us, arrangers would do. But that's because we developed a huge bag of tricks to handle just about anything a melody does. So you can't take a melody and have it do things that a competent barbershop arranger can't handle. There's enough tools in the toolkit to make it work. And that's a great illustration of that fact. And that's something we just take for granted. You know, we listen to that song and say, yeah, that's straightforward barbershop. And it is, but it represents many years of growth and development in barbershop arranging. Here's one of the classic ones. this is the rose chord. And this is an old barbershop ism where the tenor starts here, goes down a half step, and your ear kind of tells you want to go down another half step, but you don't. So you just stay on the same note. As a matter of fact, if you tune it correctly, you lift it a little bit. And here, the melody sings right up the scale in half steps. That is what's called the rose chord. It's also in, what is it, Sweet and Lovely?
Sweet Roses of Morn.
Sweet Roses of Morn, yeah. Sweet Roses. You're the ideal. You're the I. Stays right across, right? That's the rose chord. The rose chord is actually three chords. It's those three chords, and it's the tenor non-descent into the, you know, into the natural there. Grandma's Boys. Yeah, we wouldn't remember them as being one of the great singing quartets, but they were certainly one of the most entertaining, and they had one of the greatest visual packages ever. Okay, so I actually have video of their famous toy soldier thing. It's not high quality video, but you'll get the gist. So this is 1979. These guys just walked out there and nobody was expecting this. As a matter of fact, I think they had done the toy soldier thing the year before. And then they came out and did it again, and they also had another football hero set. So basically two of their three sets were very special. They were choreographed, they were costumed, and it was pretty spectacular.
Ra-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, see the toy soldiers march on parade. Gee, it's great to hear a military band when the toy soldiers march on parade. You know they've gotta be the finest in the land. Those mechanical marching men are almost sure to make you grin. They'll effectively do you in
when they play.
When they play, see the toy soldiers marching on parade. Gee, it's gonna be a great, great day. Ra-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. Mechanical Sam, the music man, the leader of the band. And technical Tommy, tootin' the tube, but gee, the music's grand.
see them marching down the avenue, coming into view with a doodly-doot-dee-doo. Fight and round and build a code, you make your spirits high. Laying a double 40 to the sky. The cymbals crash, the cannons roar. Golly, I can't take any more when the toy soldiers march on parade.
See the toy soldiers
marching, marching on parade.
Gee, it's great to hear a military band.
When the toy soldiers march on parade,
you know they've got a need to find in the land.
Those mechanical marching men are almost sure to make you grin. You can battle it in by shouting
right away.
Hip hip hooray, see the toy soldiers marching on parade. Gee, it's gonna be a great, great day today. It's gonna be a great, great day. We're gonna shout hooray! Hey!
Clever, yeah? Very clever. This is J.G. Lombardo. He was the baritone of that group. he was had many accomplishments. He's a very accomplished arranger. He's also the was the director of the New Tradition Chorus, who all the way through the 1990s placed second, and were famous for being second that number of years, and finally they won. I guess it was 2001, yes. Society Hall of Fame in 2012. what else do I need to say about Jay? He really is a good arranger. And Jay is one of these guys, he's like Ed Wasey in a sense that he doesn't write complicated things. I've never seen an extremely complex J.G. Lombardo arrangement, but yet there are very, very, there's a lot of very, very good arrangements that are just elegant. He's got a good touch. He's a very musical person. Boston Common, totally different, completely different from Grandma's Boys, completely different from bluegrass. Some people try to say that, well, in the 70s and 80s, everybody sounded alike, but it's not the case, not at all. I mean, here's three successive champions that were totally different from each other. This was kind of a throwback to, in some sense, the old freewheeling quartet sound. They had a huge sound. It was a very natural delivery. They did very little to cater to the judging panel, which is why it probably took them so long to win, because all the way through the later part of the 70s, they were a very popular quartet, and a lot of people were getting annoyed that they weren't winning. And of course, judges said, well, they don't do anything interpretively with their songs, they just sing. And that's kind of the case. They just opened their mouth and sang, but it was so good, nobody cared. And finally, in this year, in 1980, it got to be a point where the judges couldn't hold them back any longer, and they had to let them win. So this is the Boston Common.
There's something about the old songs we really can't explain. There's something about those melodies that keeps pounding on my brain. Can't we keep the memories of all those days gone by? They may be gone forever, but this we can't deny. Sing a song about the babbling brook, a little babbling brook beside a shady nook. But we haven't heard those pretty words for so darn long. We kind of miss those good old songs they used to sing about the man up in the moon.
So there you hear, you didn't hear many dynamic changes, right? You didn't hear any interpretive devices. They were together, but not to a fault. the tenor has a little bit of vibrato. By the way, our committee that was suggesting 10 best tenors had Kent Martin on the list of in the 10 best tenors. He just had a full voice. Everybody remembers him singing the solo on the song We Three. And the Boston Common, their two or three recordings are also available in a Masterworks, and I strongly recommend getting their recordings. All right, now here's somebody who really deserves one. This is Lou Perry, who wrote the arrangements for the Boston Common, most of the arrangements, not all, but most. And he had, as I think I mentioned him back when we introduced the Four Statesmen, he wrote their arrangements. He was also mentor and arranger for a group called the Four Rascals. And actually, there's a gentleman here at Harmony College, Don Dobson, who was the tenor of the Four Rascals. And he and I were just having lunch together earlier this week, and he told me about how the Four Rascals always woodshedded, you know, chord by chord, a careful woodshedding, but they worked out their arrangements by ear until Lou Perry came along. And Lou Perry, they wanted him to arrange for them. And so they sent him the sheet music. Oh, here's what they had heard. They'd heard a song, heard a quartet singing the song Little Pal. And they'd asked that quartet if they would share the arrangement, and they said no. So he just got the composer's music, Don Dobson did, and he sent it to Lou Perry. And Lou Perry took one look at the song and says, "That I'm not going to arrange that. That song doesn't barbershop very well." But according to Don, Lou got snowed in one weekend and he got bored. And so he had that thing sitting on his piano and he finally sat down and they worked out the classic arrangement of Little Pal, sent it to them, and that became their signature song. And that quartet, the Four Rascals, were the ones who introduced the classic Lou Perry Little Pal to the world. But he's the one who arranged that old quartet of mine, There's Something I Like About Broadway. And, you know, If the Rest of the World Don't Want You, a number of songs that have been sung. I only go to see a show about the Song and Dance Man, the one that the Four Statesmen sang, that was his arrangement. But I think other than Forgive Me, everything that they sang in contest was arranged, that Boston Common sang, was arranged by Lou Perry. Hall of Famer. And I should say a little bit about Lou's philosophy. He really felt strongly that barbershop should be uncomplicated. And if he were around today, he would be objecting to the level of complexity in our arrangements. He would probably say, Aaron Dale is not arranging good barbershop. Me too. But on the other hand, I think he taught us something. I think we all learned something from his, you know, tasteful simplicity. So this is Chicago News. Chicago News featured as bass Tom Felgen, and he had been bass of the Four Renegades. And I'm trying to think, does that make him the fourth person who had won two gold medals? I remember being there at that live performance, and I thought that tag was just, I mean, it was very old-fashioned. There was nothing fancy about it, but somehow it just cut through with its simplicity and its ring. And the recording doesn't quite do justice to this guy, Ray Hinders, who really, really, he was a falsetto tenor, but man, could he lay it out there. And when he posted that post at the end, it was pretty spectacular. Thoroughbreds was, I would say, another of the great early choruses. We talked about the vocal majority and saw a video of them, but they were champions all these years, not as many as the vocal majority, but a whole bunch of them, and their great director was Jim Miller for most of those years. So this is not from the contest, but from after the contest. And I'm sorry, I wish I had the actual contest, but you get the idea of this thing. There are certain things that if you were there in the house when it happened, you will never forget it. That's one of them. I was there, it was like, holy cow. I just thought, I've never seen anything like that. And the power of their singing may sound a little brash to us now, but at the moment it was pretty impressive. Classic collection. Hadn't been too long before this that all of Colorado and into maybe into Utah was part of the Central States District. So when this quartet started, they were in the Central States District. But I believe by the time they won, they had created the Rocky Mountain District. And so they represented the Rocky Mountain District.
I'm so glad I found you all, you beautiful doll, you great big beautiful doll. Never ever leave me or my heart will ache. I wanna hug you, baby, please don't break. Oh, 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 you beautiful doll. Oh, you beautiful, simply marvelous. Oh, you beautiful, great big beautiful doll.
And that was the year that, you know, now what was happening, now that's a live recording, it probably didn't do these guys quite justice, sounds a little pushed, but it was true that this was a time when a lot of the good top quartets were singing a lot of loud stuff. And I remember it being a huge, huge topic of conversation in the judging meetings, because by now I was in the arrangement category. I was a judge in the arrangement category. And a lot of the discussion was, what do we got to do? What do we have to do to curb such loud singing? They felt like the quartets were singing, over singing. And a few years later, there was a quartet called the Rapscallions that you'll hear. And they were sort of the ultimate thing. It was sort of like after that happened, then they really, really started scoring down quartets that just pushed. Greg Lyne wrote the arrangement you just heard of "Oh, You Beautiful Doll," and was prime coach for Classic Edition and Classic Collection. Excuse me. There's a female champion called Classic Edition, so I get confused. Hall of Fame, 2013. Greg has been huge in barbershopping and in our society. Ranger judge, coach, chorus director, who directed the Masters of Harmony to international champions maybe three times, maybe two, but he directed the Lombard West Towns Chorus from Chicago to an international champion before that. And he did serve as our society's musical services director in that time interval, 1997 to 2005. During which time he was Dean of Harmony College. He was a huge, huge presence. And he came to our society as musical service director from being the director of choral studies at Arizona State or University of Arizona, I'm trying to think. Is Arizona State, yeah, which has an excellent program. So he's a PhD, music PhD, choral director, outside of barbershop. This is the Gem City Chorus. I mention them because they may be the first of the great dynasty female choruses. Director Jean Barford, whose husband Brian Barford is a judge in our society. Jean is a well-known coach and director, and they were champions in Sweet Adelines a lot of times. And in addition to being champions all those years, four times they were silver medalists. So I just have a soundbite for them, but they kind of sang women's barbershop like the Thoroughbreds sang men's barbershop. It was right on that ragged edge of being over the top, but exciting for sure.
I will be right there with bells when that old conductor yells, all aboard, all aboard, all aboard for Alabama. When that midnight choo-choo leaves for Alabama, I'll be right there, right there. I've got my fare, I declare, when I see that rusty-haired conductor man. I'll grab him by the collar and I'll holler, Alabama, Alabama, that's where you stop your train, that brings
pretty much right in your face. This is Joe Lyles. Joe is still living, still working with the music publications program as a consultant, although he didn't ever move down to Nashville. He still lives in Kenosha, where our society headquarters were formerly. Arranger and composer of a lot of popular songs in Barbershop, like The Moment I Saw Your Eyes, I Didn't Want to Fall, which he composed with Val Hicks. He joined the international staff in 1975. About the time I joined Barbershop, Joe Lyles was on the international staff. And he has been one of my idols in Barbershop for all of these years. I think I've always liked Joe's philosophy. You know, he was a true blue barbershopper, but he always was in favor of moving forward with Barbershop, not just letting it be stagnant and stay right where it is. And he was, while other people didn't approve of changes that were happening, Joe always looked on it favorably, and I always viewed him as a very, very wise man. He was a musical service director, and there's that apostrophe again. I guess I'm going to fix it. And actually executive director from this interval, and made the Society Hall of Fame. And this song, popular Joe Lyles song, is one of many of his that sings equally well for men and for women. He tends to write and arrange so that the voicings are tight. There's nothing exotic, rangy, or anything about anything Joe Lyles has ever written. So as a result, nearly anything he's done, if he did it for women, you can sing it with men, vice versa. So The Moment I Saw Your Eyes, there it is. The men's version's very popular. It was sung by the Gas House Gang, sang it when they, maybe not when they won, but they sang it when they made silver medal for sure. There it is in the key of C, men's version. There it is in the key of F, women's version. Now, I know this one looks lower than that one, but actually it's pitched up. And that's because our treble clef is not the usual treble clef. You see the little symbol 8 there, which should always be there. That means that middle C is up there in the middle of the clef. We sing the honest bass clef. Women sing the honest treble clef, but their bass clef is an octave higher than what it should be. So anyway, this is what women's barbershop looks like. Looks like it's men's barbershop really low. Side Street Ramblers, 1983. Brian Beck was the baritone of the dealer's choice. He was the lead of the Side Street Ramblers.
No matter what she is, wherever she may be, if no one wants her now, please send her home to me. Welcome back, my Sally, that old gal of mine. Sally, my sweetheart divine.
And in addition to Brian's remarkable vocal talent, he also is arranger and composer. He wrote that song, as well as arranged it, that you just heard. And he also wrote the song, I'm Sorry I Made You Cry, and arranged it. And this is the song with the famous cry tag. Now, I will never forget. We talked about moments you won't forget. You were there. I believe it was the finals, top 10. And they're singing this song, and all of a sudden, four voices are in unison. There's nothing that grabs you in music when you've been hearing harmony like a unison. So all of a sudden, in a C of four-part harmony, pow, all four voices were on an F sharp. An F sharp. And it was just one of those moments there, you know, holy cow. And then they did this blossom off and ended that, and that was enough for, that was a standing O right there, let me tell you. Yeah. Now, rapscallions, you may recognize that fellow right there, Jeff Oxley. Certainly one of the greatest bass singers ever. I'm not sure you would have made him the greatest bass singer ever from being in this quartet, although they were a great quartet, but he's established himself so much more and matured so much more as a singer since then that you'd have to say, you know, who can do it better than Jeff Oxley? Probably nobody. But this was, as I said, this was in the middle of the loud craze, and this quartet was incredibly loud. This international was in my home city of St. Louis, and I remember just thinking, holy cow, you know, I've never heard decibels like this. And it wasn't just them, it was a lot of the top 10 quartets.
They always call him Mr. Touchdown. They always call him Mr. T.E.M. He can run and he can throw. Just give him the ball and yell, go, go, go. Hooray, Mr. Touchdown. He's gonna beat him today. So cheer, cheer for old Notre Dame and Mr. Touchdown USA. Rah, 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 rah. Mr. Touchdown USA. He'll make the play, win the day, he'll win the day.
And then there was this quartet, the New Tradition. They did something like what Grandma's Boys did. They brought to stage a routine that was incredibly inventive, and that, again, if you were there, you'll remember it. And I actually do have video of their Marx Brothers thing. So this was something that, I won't say anything, you watch it. Again, the quality isn't good.
The New Tradition!
John Miller had been the bass of Grandma's Boys. And this is his second gold medal. Songs on here, but what's funny is what they do in between songs.
Don't go away.
Don't go away.
I mean, the long applause just supported all of that. You know, they just kept it going. It never went dead. Never went dead. This is Justin Miller, now the director of the Westminster Chorus, who was there at that contest. He is the son of John Miller. And there he is. They dressed him up as a little Groucho Marx. And he walked around with his dad as they were singing in the afterglows and hospitality rooms. And I need to update that. Champions in 2010, 2015, and, oh, I do, I've got it. I did it, and a silver medal in 2013. Okay, so we're up to date on that. Some of their songs were arranged by Tom Gentry. The most famous one is probably Mother Kiss Your Boy Goodbye. But another one that got sang a lot back then is No One Knows You Any Better Than Your M-A-Double-M-Y. And then there was Smile. We still sing this. The famous Smile tag was actually put on that song by Bobby Gray. But the rest of the arrangement came from Tom Gentry. He is with us on the faculty this week. And music judge, former category specialist of the music category, formerly before that, an arrangement judge, which is where I first got to know Tom. Rural Route 4, always dressed in coveralls. These two guys in the middle were brothers. They are Mennonites from western part of the state of Kansas, near Kansas City. Jim Bagby, the baritone, is coach and director, directed Heart of America Chorus in Kansas City for many years. And this quartet was known for their very heartfelt performances.
I thought that I was wrong.
Now this is timing to your apron strings again, which we heard the 14s singing from 1952. Different arrangement, same song.
Please take me back tonight, where I belong. Sing a cradle song to me, and then won't you tie me to your apron strings again. That
song was very touching, and when the bass, Will Yoder, took that melody at the end, it tugged at your heart. Women's quartet, ambiance, probably the best one ever. There's the baritone right there. These gals could sing. This was my first, wonderful experience with arranging, because I was doing their stuff, and the voices, really beat anything I'd ever heard before, and still, I've done a lot of things for some excellent groups, but I still have to say there are some things about this particular ensemble that I've never, ever encountered since then. So this is, I believe I have a video.
I never knew you were meant for me. You never knew I was meant for you. Nature patterned you, and when she was done, you were all the sweet things rolled into one. You're like a plaintive melody,
a melody
that never lets me free. I'm content, the angels must have sent you, and they meant you just for me.
For you,
you for me. Now I can't sleep, and I can't eat. I never knew a single soul could be so sweet. I never knew I could love anybody. Sure as there's a sun above, honey, you're the one I love.
And so if you have any questions about ambiance, you can ask her. That like the great champions, they were more known for their stuff that they did thereafter. They made three great recordings. I would recommend them all to you. And they really made a national impact because they made an appearance on national public radio. It attracted a lot of attention after they were aired nationally. And it featured their recording of the adaptation of Rhapsody in Blue. So here's a little bit of that. It's very dramatic, the way they were able to handle this vocally.
The sound all around.
So, there's my characterizing features of Barbershop. I find that Barbershop of all ages satisfies these. You've seen that before. This is Joe Connolly's first gold medal, the Interstate Rivals. They were four young men in the thoroughbreds, and all four of these guys would go on to win gold medals in other quartets. Kip in the Gas House Gang, and then in Old School. Joe Connolly would become the only four-time gold medalist with Keepsake, Platinum, and Old School after this. Jay Hawkins and Paul Gilman both sang in Marquee.
There came a time we said goodbye. We've been apart since then. And no one knows as well as I. He won't be back.
Classic move, change the voicing. You get a hint of Joe Connolly's smoothness as a lead, which would, of course, develop much further in the 1990s. But there he is as a very young man, and already you can hear that style in his voice. This is the Chiefs of Staff. Again, completely different sound. Chuck Sisson, huge voice, vibrato. These guys could blow you out of the room. Wasn't locked up like other quartets, but you sort of didn't care because it was just artistic.
And I wake from each dream of your loveliness to sink once again into loneliness. And I'd give all the world for just one caress. I'm lonesome, I guess. That's all.
That's a great progression right there. I've always loved that. Here's a good tag. Ed Wasey. Isn't that great? Second edition. This quartet didn't last a long time, but I think they had many, many accomplishments. One of them is that they sang so well. And David Harrington's voice, the lead, is just incredible. And also, this quartet had a huge impact with the worldwide community. They sang in New Zealand. And basically, I think you can say that their singing in New Zealand inspired New Zealand barbershopping to exist. It was already there, but they went over there and made a huge impact. And a very young girl, Charlotte Murray, heard them singing, and she is now the director of vocal effects. I mean, this, you know, fairly shy woman has done huge amounts with barbershop in New Zealand. And New Zealand has a huge, huge youth movement. They teach, there are many, many schools in New Zealand where barbershop is taught by the music teacher. And they have a national festival that their barbershop ensembles have to qualify to get to. And I happened to be at that festival last August. And there were 700 youths, boys and girls, 700. And those were the only ones that qualified to get there. So this is huge over there. There's a lot of barbershop going on in New Zealand. And I think Second Edition had a lot to do with it, because when they went over there and sang, people just fell all over them. Ed Wayshe's arranging. He did a lot of their stuff.
So sorry when she started
to cry.
Oh, how she cried, how she cried. Oh, won't you come home, Bill Bailey? Won't you come home?
Come on,
she moans the whole day long.
The whole day long.
I'll do cooking, honey, I'll pay the rent. I know I've done you wrong. I know I'm wrong. Remember that rainy evening I drove you out with nothing but a fine tooth comb. I know I'm to blame. Well, ain't that a shame? Oh, Bill Bailey, won't you please come home? But then old Bill replied,
my name is Bailey, woman, first name of Bill, and you can moan the whole day long. I ain't cooking no dinner, honey, ain't gonna pay the rent, and everybody knows you've done me wrong. Woman, you best remember
that rainy evening you threw me out with nothing but a fine tooth comb.
Well, the world knows you're to blame.
That's a doggone crying shame. And old Bill ain't coming home till you and your mama both exclaim, Bill Bailey, won't you please come right back home? Come on, home.
Yeah, and another thing is, this quartet teamed up with a young Swedish quartet called the Growing Girls. We'll see them, who were champions. They were young girls, and they sang eight-part stuff and did many, many shows together, both in Sweden and in America. And the bass married the bass. Jamie Meyer married Naima. And actually, Doug, the baritone, married Suzanne, the lead. Their marriages, they seem to be separated now. They were, you know, kind of a kick for barbershopping, just all these young, talented people. And it was another young quartet, you know. Somehow, young quartets inspire us, and especially one that can sing that well. They had a big ringing sound, and I think even though they didn't last all that long, they really made a pretty huge impact on the culture. This is the Growing Girls. They just had a reunion, got back together, and sang on the Sweet Adeline's Coronet Club show, their AIC, their champion show, last year in Baltimore. And they did a pretty darn good job. They sounded pretty good.
Put your arms around me, honey. honey. Hold me tight, huddle up and cuddle up with all your might. Oh my, won't you roll those eyes? Those eyes, I just idolize. When they look at me, my heart begins to float. Then it starts a rocking like a motorboat. Oh, I never knew I could love anybody like you. You know it's true, I want you. Oh my, do I, honey, did I do? And do I need you? Oh my, do I, honey, did I do? I do. I'm glad that I'm the one who found you. That's why I'm always hanging around you. And do I love you? Oh, my, do I? Honey, did I do? You know it's true. I've told the moon and stars above that you're the only one I love. Honey, you're the one for me.
Okay, well, we wrap up another day. Tomorrow we'll try to get up to and including the current champions. So see you tomorrow.